Week begins like a Monday like this, the 12th of July 2021. And like we always start our programming in the morning with a flagship radio lecture series. This morning, going to all of our 300 students of the University of Education Winneba, studying the course EDCR 242 Trends in Education and School Management in Ghana. Remember, your radio lecture is set right about now. Even as we have in the studios, Mr. Eric Ofosu Jamina from the Department of Educational Foundations, University of Education, Winneba. He's making a presentation this morning on behavioral and contingency series. Remember, after the radio lecture, our program, Windy Morning Express, continues right here with Kimba Tuka, 98.3 FM. Don't forget to come through as far as the radio lecture is concerned on 0503-923158. 0503-923158. So on behalf of the team, we welcome you here to the Dow Radio Windy Bay 98.3 FM. And without much ado, I say very good morning to you, Mr. Eric Ofosu Jamina, and over to you.
Our level 300 students reading Trends in Education and School Management in Ghana, EDCR 242. Yeah, this morning you're going to look briefly at some theories. And you might have started with those theories already in various lecture halls. You might have dealt with the great man theory and the trait theory. And those of you who are doing the reading, you might have realize that leadership theory seems to undergo a developing continuum, or evolving beyond the great man assertion that leaders are born with a unique success-driven disposition. The trait theory then suggested that leadership potential can be measured and analyzed. Yes, it continues to evolve as it is. And researchers have found out that there's that notion concerning great man and the trait theories. And they have come out with the realization that with every individual, you can train the one with the various methods and strategies required so that the person can be assigned leadership positions. Initially, people didn't think that they needed to be trained as a leader. If we take the school leader, for instance, the head of a school, yes, you might be the school head in name, but that won't inherently make your teachers like you. Your teachers might not even respect you or do what you tell them to do. Someone can simply say that yes, we are all leaders. Truly, we are leaders, but what kind of leader are you? So by the end of this presentation, you will be able to identify what kind of leader you are, what kind of leader you want to be, and how to bridge the gap through your behavior. So we first look at the behavioral theory of leadership. Yes, everywhere you can hear that great leaders are born, not made. This was the core of the original idea behind what made an effective leader. That's referring to the great man theory. But after its proposal in the 1800s by Thomas Carlyle, the great man theory, the trait theory of leadership, served as one of the most widespread ideas on what makes a great leader. We could count so many examples of why this seems ridiculous. Ridiculous in the sense that how do you see somebody so stout, so strong, and you think, yes, he should be a leader. But we realize that by a person's nature, That's the way the individual is brought up. And what they do with their life plays such a key role in their ability to fit a certain role that the theory seems incredibly close-minded. But unfortunately, that was the dominant theory. So you couldn't just look at how stout or strongly built somebody is and say that that person definitely ought to be a leader. Then the trait theory was also tested and studied and was discovered, measurably so, that there are few natural traits that differentiate leaders from followers. In other words, leaders are made, not born. You can argue about this. Yes, if leaders are born and not made, then it means that there could be some characteristic features of our leaders which we, the followers, might not have at all, so that there could be a clear line between who the leader is and who the follower is. But a new approach is actually needed in here. So we enter the realms of the behavioral theory of leadership. And this is very simple. As said, if there are few natural traits exclusive to effective leaders, perhaps leaders are not born. They are made. So following this logic, if leaders are made, there must be some consistencies in the environment and behaviors that the individual is exposed to and learns to adopt. This, in theory, means that anyone could become a great leader if they were taught the same behaviors. And according to this theory, it isn't inherent characteristics that make a good leader. A leader makes themselves effective through the way they act and what they do. There are quite a number of types of behavioral leaders. If we try to identify it, it could be well over 80. Over and above 80, so to say. But with our limited time here, we can't mention all of them. But if time will permit me, maybe I can take about 10 of the most important types of leaders through their behaviors. And some of them are: one, we have the task-oriented leader. We have the people-oriented leader, participative leadership, indifferent club, country club leaders, status quo leaders, dictatorial leaders, sound or team leaders. And we also have the opportunistic leaders and paternalistic leadership style. So per behavior, we have the LBDQ, a study that was done using a questionnaire which was simply referred to as the LBDQ, that is the Leaders Behavior Description Questionnaire. And the result of the study came out to let everyone know that, yes, leadership is learned and not that someone is actually born with it. And that study was undertaken by the Ohio State University in the year 1940 or around the 1940s. So they gave the questionnaire to groups ranging from college students to administrators and private companies and to military personnel. The goal for the study was to find common leadership behaviors. We are talking of behaviors. And the study came out that two behavioral groups in particular were commonly related to effective leadership. and these were tax oriented leaders and people oriented leaders. Maybe you take some little time to look at what we mean by tax oriented leaders. They are primarily concerned with the systems and structure that lets their team carry out their work. The tax oriented leaders, they look at the workplace, whatever inputs that are required, they make sure that they provide them. That doesn't mean that they were not looking at the personnel or the people working in there as workers. They also took care of them. So this includes everything from tax description to standard operating procedures, organizational and team structure, communication lines, and what have you. They were taking care of everything concerning that particular organization so that the system can actually work. So with this, we're saying that they also took care of the employees and regarding them as human beings. They were so concerned, or they are so concerned about the workers, trying to motivate them, trying to see them work as a team, irrespective of the fact that their main concern is about the systems, to ensure that the system works. Should the system work, then of course you need your workers to work together as one. So tax-oriented leaders exhibited some of these behaviors. They were initiating, they were organizing, clarifying, and were involved in information gathering. The other side of the study that looked at the behaviors also identified the people-oriented leaders. So with the people-oriented leaders, when the LBDQ was used, unlike the task-oriented leaders, this group puts more efforts, I'm talking of the people-oriented leaders, they put more efforts into seeing to human needs of their team, that is their workers, and motivating them through that. Not that they were not focusing on the task or the organizational system as it is. They just put more time and behavioral focus on their team and regarding them as people with wants and needs. So for instance, let's say your team is having a problem, your teachers in the school, they're having a problem. Someone hasn't maybe prepared his lesson notes to go to the classroom to teach. What do you do? The task-oriented leader will dive into your processes to see if the problem could be prevented in the future. Inspectors have come to your school to see how things are done in the school. That teacher was identified as not preparing lesson notes or lesson plans. Quickly, the leader would go into whatever processes are concerned to identify if the problem could be prevented in the future. The people-oriented leader in this situation will behave differently. He might go straight to the worker or that teacher and ask if there was any way he could help that teacher, and will also identify what caused that problem that prevented him from writing his lesson notes, and will do everything possible to ensure that that teacher is brought back to track, find time to write his lesson notes according to what is expected of the system. So we see people-oriented leaders to exhibit some of these behaviors, encouraging observing, listening, coaching, and even mentoring, because they need the workers, they need the personnel to be brought up to standard so they can work in a very effective manner. The study also enabled us to have another type of leadership, that is participative. So we realized that with the participative behavior, as the name suggests, the leaders are those who consult their entire team when creating systems and methods for achieving the team's goals. This implies that work becomes more collaborative, allowing the entire team to take part in whatever is happening. They ensure that they own the work that they are doing and whatever procedures that are behind it. This means that they will be more motivated to carry out the processes more consistently and accurately because they are part of it. So by including a team in the decision-making process, yes, you help them to understand what they are supposed to do in terms of work, why it matters, and the need to motivate them to take appropriate action. So there are a lot of benefits to this kind of behavior if the leader exhibits it at the workplace. So one of the biggest benefits of this behavioral leadership theory is that it allows the team to take advantage of everyone's strengths. We are together, and together we work towards the attainment of our set goals. So every team member's voice is heard, encouraging creativity and engagement, and it also provides an avenue for new leaders to show their abilities and for everyone to make the most of each other's strengths. And as it is, this in one way or the other encourages communication and collaboration, which can often lead to a thriving organizational culture. However, there is a downside to this. To every merit, there are demerits. So the downside is that participative leadership takes much more time than other methods. Having to speak to everyone means that there will be a much greater delay before action is taken. So for participative leaders, we can identify that they exhibit such behaviors as communicating, collaborating, being open to feedback, encouraging, and they even go to the extent of delegating. There are other forms of this behavioral aspect of the management. We have indifferent or impoverished leaders, and the study was done by Blake and Martin, which resulted in the drawing of what we refer to as the managerial grid model, where in that model we have the consent for people being arranged on the y-axis, the vertical axis, and the consent for production arranged on the horizontal axis, that's the x-axis. So when you do the pairings, there are 9 items on the vertical bar and there are 9 items on the horizontal bar. So pairing these, you are going to get about 81 different forms of behavior. And I request that those of you who have the chance to read, you can read about this model, then identify the various types of behavior that leaders can possess, and which one helps with the achievement of goals and objectives of that organization in a better manner. So our studio lines are activated. You can start pushing through your questions, your contributions, and if there are any queries also, you can add it. We have 050-392-3158. 050-392-3158. You can call, you can send your texts. There are other ways that you can reach us at the studio here, by way of sending a WhatsApp or a text message through 050-392-3158. So we talked about the behavioral theory, and we realized that the main focus is on behaviors of actual leaders. It determines how various kinds of specific leaders' behavior affect the performance and satisfaction of leaders. According to this theory, people can learn to become leaders through teaching and observation. The behavioral approach says that anyone who adopts the appropriate behavior can be a good leader. And there are ways by which you can improve your leadership skills. First, you can have a clear vision. You should know and utilize your strengths and your gifts. You must be passionate. You must live in accordance with your morals and values. You can serve as a role model. You must set definitive goals and follow concrete action plans. You maintain a positive attitude. You improve communication skills, and you motivate others to greatness as you continue to educate and improve yourself. So, in summary, I'll say that behaviors are simply the actions and inactions exhibited by a person over a period of time, and as realized, some basic assumptions are: leaders can be made rather than are born, and successful leadership is based on definable and learnable behavior. And as it is, anyone can learn to become a leader. A leader's behavior determines the kind of followers he or she has. People can leave their bad behavior for good. And the reverse is also true. But we all learn to portray good behavior as leaders. And this promotes the value of leadership style with an emphasis on concern for people and collaboration. The behavioral theory may help leaders to develop particular leadership behavior, but they provide little guidance as to how effective leadership can be applied in different situations. The style that leaders can adopt are more affected by those that they are working with and the environment they are operating within. And as it is, research has enabled us to identify that no one leadership style is right for every leader under all circumstances. And this statement is taking us to another theory, which we refer to as the contingency theory of management. We have said that leadership theories are in the form of a continuum. We have looked at the great man theory, we have looked at the trait theory, we have added the behavioral theory. We now move on to the contingency theory of management. So we realize that the behavior of a leader depends upon characteristics of the situation that the leader is in. If you look at the way we talk about whatever behavior the leader is portraying, whether it's going to be a people-oriented person or a task-oriented person, the way he behaves depends upon the nature of the situation he finds himself. And this implies that the conditions will either enable the person to be an employee-oriented, that is people-oriented, or they will be more effective as production or work-oriented leader. And with the contingency theory, we have some popular theories. There are a lot of theories as regards this, but few of them are regarded as being popular. First, we have fearless theory. We have the path goal theory. And we have the situational leadership theory. All these come under the contingency theory. They talk of a situation where there is no one best way to do things. Fiedler, 1964, made a statement that there is no one best way of organizing or leading, and that leadership style is effective in some situations, or a leadership style that is effective in a particular situation may not be successful in others. He talks of no one best way of leading, and per that he continues to say that whichever style you are using as a leader, at a particular point in time your style of leadership will be very effective, but that same style will not be equally effective in some other situations. In the optimal organization, leadership style is contingent upon various internal and external constraints. We have William Scott, who stated that the best way to organize depends on the nature of the environment to which the organization must relate. Yes, there are a lot of important ideas regarding the contingency theory, which we have to note so well. First, we say that there is no universal or one best way to manage an organization. If you are a school leader, you wouldn't have an absolute way of managing your school or running your school to say that I am with this and that is what I am using throughout. No. There are wide ranges of external and internal factors which must be considered, and the focus should be on the action that best fits the given situation. Whatever situation you have, the situation determines how best you can manage it to a successful end. And effective organizations not only have a proper fit with the environment, but also between its subsystems. An organization is the subsystems that determines how it must be run. And the good leader identifies what is good for the organization at any point in time and acts accordingly. So the needs of an organization are better satisfied when it is properly designed and the management style is appropriate both to the task undertaken and the nature of the work group. And for that matter, each manager's situation must be viewed separately. The heads or the managers need to be developed in skills, and most useful, or skills that are most useful in identifying the important situational factors. Looking at the situational theory, there are some properties to it. Realize that the theory is practical and is equally important for every organization. The situational theory or the contingency theory is something that is practical, and as such, it is important for every group, every organization, and every institution. Because the theory doesn't believe in one best way. So many methods and principles may be used in here. It is incumbent upon the leader to have that eye of observing whatever is happening on the ground and adopt a way of ensuring success. So every situation is unique, and for that matter, the manager has to be able to analyze each and every situation individually. You don't treat things in unison, but you look at what is existing at a time and provide answers to it. For instance, an authoritarian leader's leadership style could be more appropriate than a leadership style that tries to get workers internally motivated. If you are that leader who is experiencing situations where, let's say, you are at the head of a school, your teachers are habitual late comers, what do you do? Will you sit down for this to go on? When you have realized that, you find a way. What are you going to do? You can adopt the authoritarian leadership style to ensure that you address the situation. When the situation is normalized, you can also adopt another style, maybe democratic, and then run your school in line with that. So applied in activities of motivating, leading, and structuring the organization, you can apply all these in your school, in your groups, in your associations, in your organizations as a leader. Well, there are other potentials if you want to apply the contingency theory. You can have employee development and training. Let's say decision on decentralization. You can also establish communication and control systems. And again, plan information decision systems. All these can help you identify what is on the ground and attend to it accordingly. The contingency theory cannot go without any criticisms. There are others who think that the logical extension of the contingency approach is that all situations are unique. If this is true, then management can be practiced only by intuition and judgment, thereby negating the value of prior knowledge and wisdom. Others also critique that on research level, the contingency theory has been criticized for being a theoretical. People think, well, these things might not work as it is, but if you are a leader and you try it out, you could see that yes, it's really practical. By applying the contingency theory in your managerial systems or situations, you'll be able to identify and solve problems under different situations. This is a very positive effect of the contingency theory. You realize that successful application of a technique in one situation does not in any way guarantee success in another. So you tend to be very creative. In that new situation, you also find a way of ensuring that you successfully overcome whatever problem there is or problems that are existing in that second situation. You will be able to examine each situation in terms of how it is affected by the contextual, how it's affected by the organizational, and how it's affected by the human dimensions. You need to attend to all these aspects to ensure that things work well to promote the organizational aspirations and lead to your attainment of goals. So, as a result, your overall ability to correct problems and to become more effective as a manager will surely increase, because you are looking at the system in its entirety. Contextually, you are looking at it. Organizationally, yes. And in terms of the workers or the employers, you know what to do at any time. So we can talk about the application of the contingency perspective, that it enables the manager to examine the situation and to determine the course that will lead to a teacher being sort of queried by an officer, an external officer that comes to visit the school. You'll be able to identify this, and then the next procedure is to see how best you can address the situation, and you follow it by how best whatever you have identified and found a solution to it can work properly in the system. So the contingency theory is designed to provide the manager, the school head, or the leader with the capabilities to examine numerous possible solutions to a problem. So this helps the leader to bring all his faculties to work and helps him to be very creative. It makes him responsible, and he is always at the point of solving problems and ensuring that everything about the workplace is working in line with set standards. Yes, my dear friends, my students especially, the phone lines are activated. The line to call, to send your message, to send your WhatsApp text, is 050-392-3158. 050-392-3158. You may call, you may send your WhatsApp or text messages. So in summary, I'll say that the basic assumptions of the contingency theory are: one, that there is no universal or one best way to lead. The design of an organization and its subsystems must fit with the environment. Yet effective organization not only have a proper fit with the environment, but also will have a fit between its subsystems. The need of an organization, or the needs of an organization or an institution, are better satisfied when properly designed and the management style is appropriate both to the task undertaken and the nature of the work group. So here, leadership style may be defined as the way leaders and employees interact with one another. Leaders could function well if they change their styles to suit the situation at hand. Along the line, I mentioned the PAT goal contingency theory. I suggest that our listeners, our third year students, will find time and read about the PAT goal theory, so to increase in knowledge concerning the contingency theory. We're still at the studio awaiting your calls, your text messages, and your WhatsApp messages also. Our studio line activated is 050-3923-158. So as we await your calls, we still can listen to some of the main themes of what we have looked at. We've realized that much as leadership is concerned, there are a lot of theories that are related to it. And one of such theories is the behavioral theory, where we mentioned that behaviors are basically the actions and inactions that are exhibited by a person over a period of time. And there are some assumptions to this that leaders can be made rather than are born, and that successful leadership is based on definable and learnable behavior. Much as we are able to say that anyone is a leader, then the implication that anyone can learn to become a leader, and that a leader's behavior determines the kind of followers that leader might have. People can change their behavior at any point in time. So when we learn to be leaders and we apply the principles of leadership that we have learned, then of course we can be identified as good leaders or effective leaders. And this promotes the value of leadership style with an emphasis on concern for people and collaboration. That is the behavioral leadership style. It promotes the value of leadership style with an emphasis on concern for people and collaboration. The behavioral theory may also help leaders develop particular leadership behavior, but they provide little guidance as to how effective leadership can be applied in different situations. This could be a criticism to the theory. The style that the leaders can adopt are more affected by those they are working with and the environment they are operating within. And again, studies have found that no one leadership style is right for every leader under all circumstances. From there, we took a look at the situational theory or the contingency theory, where we said that the basic assumption or the basic assumptions of the contingency theory include the fact that there is no one universal or one best way to lead, and the design of an organization and its subsystems must fit with the environment. We again mentioned that effective organization not only have proper fit with the environment but also between its all subsystems, and the needs of an organization are better satisfied when properly designed and the management style is appropriate both to the task undertaken and the nature of the work. We have talked about this, and we want to listen to your calls and your messages. The line again is 050-392-3158. I take it again, 050-392-3158. You can send in your calls, send your texts, either WhatsApp or SMS through this same line, 050-392-3158. Someone has sent in a message. I forced myself to read it. It says, I also support the theory of situational leadership. It's more appropriate because human beings as well as situations are complex, unpredictable, and dynamic. That is a concomitant to their dealing, that is concomitant to their dealing at every point in time. So there is no single best leadership style, but rather the situation determines the style to be adopted. There is a saying that if all you have is a hammer, you will think every person is a nail. And we thank the contributor very much, Timothy Agbetum. Pardon me, I'm not able to mention the name so well. I have Timothy Agbetum of the Geography Department, level 300. You have sent us this message. You are also in line with us that you support the situational leadership style, and the situation determines the nature of the leader. The leader has to address the situation the way he understands it, the way he looks at it, and address it accordingly. We're sitting in the studio awaiting your calls, your messages. Another message has popped in coming from Christy Amwa. How can one become a leader without having all these qualities? Chrissy Amwa, if that is a question, how can one become a leader without having all these qualities? If you don't have these qualities, I'm not sure you can become a leader. But we are saying that you can have all these qualities when you learn them. So you cannot have you cannot be a leader if you don't have the qualities. But if you want to be a leader, there is that opportunity for you to learn how to lead. So I think that is the simplest answer I can offer you for now. You need to learn and to possess the qualities. The studio lines are activated, and here again I mentioned them. We have 050-392-3158. 050-392-3158. You can send in your text messages, you can send in your WhatsApp messages, and you can send your call through 050-392-3158. You can also reach us on our Facebook page, Radio Windy Bay 98.3 FM. We still at the studio awaiting your messages, awaiting your calls. Right, our dear listeners, most especially to our third year students reading this year 242, I hope some of you are still listening. We this morning talked about the behavioral theory and the contingency theory, where we identify that the main focus of the behavioral theory is on behaviors of actual leaders, and it determines how various kinds of specific leaders' behavior affect the performance and situation or performance and satisfaction of followers. And according to this theory, we realize that people can learn to become leaders through teaching and observation. And this goes to answer to a question sent in by our dear friend Chrissy. So Chrissy is not aware that people can learn to have all the qualities of a leader and per that become effective leaders. We also realize that the behavior approach says that anyone who adopts the appropriate behavior can be a good leader. And as a leader, if we want to improve our leadership skills, we must have a clear vision. We must know and utilize our strengths, and everybody possesses some kind of gifts. You can utilize your strengths and your gifts, bring them to bear on whatever you are doing, and you will surely succeed. You also have to be very passionate as a leader, and you must live in accordance with your morals and your values. And at all times, as a leader, you must serve as a role model. As a role model, you must set definitive goals and follow concrete action plans. Where you're going to maintain a positive attitude, and for that, you should be able to improve your communication skills. There's a need for you to motivate others. You ought to motivate your personnel or your workers or your subordinates to greatness, and you should be able to continue to educate and improve yourself. So we indicated that behaviors as they are simply actions and inactions that somebody shows over a period of time. And for that matter, with the theory, the assumptions are that yes, leaders can be made rather than being born. And as related to that, successful leadership is based on definable and learnable behavior. So anyone at all can learn to become a leader. And your behavior will determine the kind of followers that you will have. This theory ensures or promotes the value of leadership style with an emphasis on concern for people and collaboration. Are you going to be people oriented or work or task oriented? Will depend on how you handle your followers. And touching on the situational theory or the contingency theory, we identify some assumptions to that, where we say that there is no universal or one best way to lead, and that the design of an organization and its subsystems must fit with the environment, and that effective organization not only have proper fit with the environment, but also between its subsystems. And the needs of an organization, the needs of an organization are better satisfied when properly designed, and the management style is appropriate both to the task that is to be undertaken and the nature of the work group. So leadership style in here may be defined as the way leaders and employees interact with one another. And leaders could function well if they change their styles to suit a situation at hand. With this, we draw the curtain close to this morning's presentation on leadership theories, where we touch on the contingency theory and behavioral theory. We thank you so much for your audience. We shall meet again next week, same time. Thank you very much.
Okay, so there you go, and many thanks to you, Mr. Eric Owusu Jamana, from the Department of Educational Foundations, University of Education, Winneba. Many thanks for this morning's presentation on behavioral and contingency theories. And I went to all of our 300 students, University of Education, Winneba, who happen to be studying the course EDCR 242, Trends in Education and School Management in Ghana. Don't forget, later this day, between 5:30 p.m. and 7 p.m., there will be another radio delivery in Kankati, the Counseling Center, University of Education, Winneba, for our prime counseling time on Radio Dapt, Nuggets for Life. And today's topic happens to be academic dishonesty, a canker of concern. Presentation will be by Dr. Daniel Buku from the Counseling Center, University of Education, Winneba. And like always do, studio line 0503923158 and 0332320201 will be activated during the live broadcast of Nugget for Life in order to accommodate your contributions. Don't forget to come through on WhatsApp and text 0503923158. You're also admonished to join the live broadcast of Nugget for Life on Facebook, Radio Winneba 98.CFM, right here. Don't forget, the Windy Morning Express continues in a bit.